All right, well, good evening, everybody. I'm really excited to be here at OII. It's my first time here, and thanks to Phil and Sam for extending the invitation to speak. So my talk tonight is entitled Harder, Better, Faster, Stronger, and it will focus on the intersection of online psychological operations and international law, which is the topic of the paper that you now hold in your hands, which is just out today, if I understand right.
That's correct.
So you're actually holding the very first few copies of the paper. So I'm actually planning on keeping this fairly conversational. So what I'll do is I'll plan to speak for about 30 minutes, and then I think we want to spend the balance of the time actually on conversation, because as you'll see, there are a lot of open questions here, and I think the paper actually is more focused on laying out those questions rather than necessarily saying, you know, this is the solution for dealing with these challenges. So the talk is really going to be in three parts. So first, we're going to cover a little bit of the recent history of online manipulation. Where it is, how it's happening, those types of questions. Second, we'll talk a little bit about the future, and talk a little bit about trends that are currently emerging in the technology and where we might be headed. And then finally, we'll talk about the intersection of these trends with the world of law and policy. So first, to give you a little bit of background about myself, my interest in these topics actually originally doesn't come from sort of online psychological operations, but instead thinking about how and why things move around the web. So for a number of years, I ran a conference called RaffleCon, which brought together people who were momentarily famous on the internet together to talk about memes and the spread of kind of cats on the internet. Some of that led to the research world. So for a period of time, I was researching at the Berkman Klein Center, or then just the Berkman Center, thinking about a lot of these issues. And most recently, I finished a two-year project with the MacArthur Foundation for this research center in New York called Data and Society. I'm thinking there specifically about the policy-making impact of intelligence systems. So broadly speaking, you know, what do we do around things like self-driving cars and high-frequency trading algorithms and things of that ilk? And more recently, I've been kind of attached to the Comprop project, monitoring kind of social media manipulation, thinking about what is the impact kind of on the stability of the international system. Most of what I want to begin today with is actually not to talk about any of these more recent projects, but actually to take you back to the heady days of 2011, and a project that I was working on with a group of friends then by the name of Pacific Social. And there, what we were doing is testing the ability for automated systems to shape behavior online. So if you remember 2011, it was when social media was still kind of becoming big and marketers were really excited about it. And there were these social media experts running around saying, you can hire me if you want to, you know, get followers on Twitter or what have you. And we said, well, we basically said, let's see whether or not these people actually have a way of actually creating social activity online, right? If they, in fact, are so good, we should be able to point them at an arbitrary group of users online, and they should be able to kind of get activity to occur, create connections, create conversation. And we want to measure that quantitatively. And this led to a series of events we called social war games, where basically people would create an account on Twitter and go in and try to create a certain number of friends within a period of time, and they would kind of race to see whether or not they could do this. And what we found is actually that the teams that were most successful were in fact teams that weren't manually operating these accounts on Twitter, but instead automating them. And these are the ones that were like winning consistently over time. And so we said, okay, let's get rid of the humans, and let's just do a competition. And we called this competition Social Bots in 2011. And our question was really simple, which is, could autonomous systems influence large social groups online? And we basically opened up a call, basically said teams can create accounts that will go in and attempt to engage with a group of users online. So if you have this kind of competition, what you need to do is first create sort of a battlefield where these teams will sort of engage with users. And so what we did is we created this kind of network of about 500 users. We basically pulled originally a group of users that were really interested in talking about cats, pulled some of their friends and some of their friends' friends. So it was kind of a semi-connected network, if you will, of users. And so teams were challenged to basically write bots to enter this group to provoke certain types of social behavior. And the trick of it was that they had to enter this community, this group of users, without anyone necessarily knowing that these accounts were in fact bots. And so what you ended up with was a kind of battle bots, but in the social space online. So there was a combination, teams were basically allowed to launch one lead bot, which I'll explain in a second, and any number of supporting bots, basically bots that could bolster the credibility of this lead bot. They could say, hey, you should really follow this guy, he's a really interesting character, and you get a lot out of following him. And then teams were scored accordingly. So we basically said, if you if your lead bot is able to convince someone to follow it back, get a mutual follow, we'll give you 1 point. We said, well, it might be really easy to get someone to follow you on Twitter, but it may be a little bit harder to get them to respond to you. So if you get a social response, you say something to someone, someone says something back, we'll give you 3 points. But at the same time, you have to remain believable, right? So if Twitter catches you and you get deleted, we're going to penalize you. You'll get docked 15 points, you'll get, you know, frozen for a period of time, and it'll take a little while for you to get back onto the platform. And so this is kind of the setup that we ended up with, and we said you can play this competition for 4 weeks, and then we'll just see what the score looks like at the very end. And so we ended up with 3 teams, ultimately. So there's one team that was kind of a marketing-related team, there's a second team that was more in the kind of computer security space, and then finally a group that was more involved in sort of computational social science. And so I want to take a moment to talk about the results that we had in 2011 first. So there's two kinds of results here. There's the results of what people did, which is useful for thinking a little bit about how these bots actually operate in practice. And then there's the part of it which is talking about how well they did. So let's talk about what they did first. So interestingly, like BattleBots, it turns out everybody has their own way of designing an automated system to try to engage with users on the internet, right? So I want to give you some of the kind of tactics that were deployed to give you a flavor for the sorts of things that were tried out. So the first one was, you know, that you may not actually need some complex AI to power a bot on the internet. What you may need is actually just a set of generic responses, right? So the bot could say things like, oh, that's great, or like, that's really interesting, tell me more about that, right? Sort of the response that would be the response to any statement in a conversation. You know, I was joking to someone the other day that like I actually use this tactic sometimes as well, and you may have as well. And the bot basically went in and did this. And it turned out that this actually was a fairly kind of successful tactic. So you can't see it from all the way over there, but basically James M. Titus is the bot here, and the account, the other account is the sort of human user they're working with. And James has a set of questions, right? Like, if you could be one character in fiction, what would it be? And the person says, oh, well, I'd be Jesus. And then they kind of go back and forth and have this conversation. And what's interesting and important here is that the bot doesn't have any logic for conversation. It's just kind of repeating these generic statements, hoping that the person will continue on in the conversation with them. So that's one kind of attempt that was tried that was fairly successful. Another one might be, well, maybe we don't actually need complex machine learning or AI. Maybe we can just paste people to write stuff for this bot, right? So the way this bot was designed was that it was hooked up to a platform called Amazon Mechanical Turk, where you can basically pay people small amounts to do small tasks for you. And so the bot would take the input for from someone. So if someone would say, who are you or what's your name? And then basically would push that to Amazon Mechanical Turk. So a human would be paid a penny or something to respond to it, and that would become the response for the bot. And so you're able to have these bots that have very realistic responses because, in fact, it is a human responding to different types of content. It's just not, you know, a real human. It's sort of algorithmically assembled. A final model, which I'll plug, is one called sort of what we call sort of leveraging content blindness. And the idea here is on social networks, it can be easy to see what your friends are doing and maybe what your friends of friends are doing. But it can be really difficult to tell what your friends of friends of friends are doing, right? Or something really far away in the network. And so the bot kind of leveraged this as its tactic, right? So it would identify two groups of users talking about roughly the same thing. And what it would do is copy the content from one and use it as its content in the other. And if anyone responded to the bot, it would use the input for one as the output for the other. So someone would say, bot, what did you have for breakfast today? And actually, somewhere else in Twitter, there'd be an account that would ask a human what they had for breakfast, copy those responses, and then push them back, right? So again, you're able to create these very human-like interactions and responses, in large part because you're sort of wiring together social interactions from different parts of the network. So that's kind of a little bit of what the teams did. One final note that I think is pretty interesting is that the teams ended up having a lot of kind of strategies they used to try to take down the credibility of the other bots in the competition. So one of the bots launched a bot called Bot Cops. And Bot Cops basically pretended to be executing a complex machine learning system to detect who was a bot and who was not, and was going around warning users that who they were talking to was a bot. Now, obviously, this was, again, a little bit of a game because there wasn't actually any bot detection going on. Basically, this account would go after people that another team was talking to and then basically try to warn them that they were talking to a bot. And certain bots fell over, right? Because people would get paranoid and you know, they would stop interacting with the lead bot of these teams. But we also saw some models that were actually fairly robust against these attacks, right? So Bot Cops here is going up against James M. Titus, and so Bot Cops is basically saying, you may want to be careful about James M. Titus. We've detected that he's a bot. And so users would say, well, how about it? Are you a bot? And James would basically laugh it off because he has a bunch of generic responses that seem appropriate for anything. So James would say, yeah, that's really funny, or like, that's ridiculous. And these bots would actually continue getting interactions from people. So a couple of really interesting dimensions to this. So talk a little about sort of what happened. So let's talk a little bit about how well they did. So in about 2 weeks, the bots together were able to create about 107 mutual follows. So they followed someone followed back. And they were able to generate something like 198, close to 200 sort of responses from people. So you know, they talked to someone talked back to them. And indeed, that these actually were generally kind of long conversations. We saw basically people, you know, saying something to the bot would say something back, and then they would say something, and we'd actually go back quite a bit. What's intriguing to us is that sort of more than kind of 50% of users were connected by these bots. And the network structure actually was very striking to us, basically, that, you know, these bots were able to create a network of users that were interacting with them very frequently. So we ended up in this really interesting place. We started with this idea of, can we just show those you know, marketing consultants that they do a bad job? But what we ended up with was software that would reliably create certain changes in the behavior of a group of people online, right? And so we got very excited by this and started to do a bunch of experiments. This is kind of 2011 at this point. And so I'll give you a flavor of those examples, and then I want to talk about what's happening while we're kind of progressing happily on this like research direction. So one of them is that we were thinking, well, okay, maybe bots can interact and connect people online, but maybe they can also influence the spread of certain types of ideas through a network. So you may be familiar with this article from The Lancet that basically put out the idea that vaccines cause autism, right? So this is misinformation, has been since retracted, but is a really pernicious piece of information online. And has led to actually a number of groups within the US actually to stop vaccinations, right, which creates all these health impacts. So we said, could we launch a bunch of bots that would basically float around the networks waiting for someone to say, oh, hey, I just saw this story that says that vaccines cause autism. And then at that point would trigger, basically executing countermeasures to say, that's not right, or maybe, you know, like, here's a bunch of things that you should take a look at, or maybe even connecting them with someone who is a strong pro-vaccine activist to get sort of a conversation emerging. And so the dream of this was, if you were able to kind of seed a bunch of these bots all over Twitter, you might actually be able to slow down the movement of certain ideas through a platform, or speed them up depending on your choice. So that's one experiment we did. Another one was thinking about a bunch of tests around measuring the capacity for information, misinformation, to spread through a network. So if you're familiar with computer security, there's the notion of penetration testing, basically where you bring in a bunch of people to a computer network and you try to find ways and weak points in that network. So one theory here was, could we send in a bunch of bots that would basically spread information? And we would see who would basically spread that information without evaluating whether or not it was true or not. Right? So the bot would say, this study says 90% of people never go to libraries, for instance, when the study actually said only 20% of people. But and we would basically see who in a network would spread it just because it was kind of an exciting headline, without necessarily clicking through to evaluate the truth of information. And if you do this over a period of time, you basically end up extracting a profile of who in a network spreads information without necessarily evaluating it. Right? And so you're actually able to find these holes within a network that, again, if you are kind of inclined in a certain way, can be used to sort of patch up or increase the credulity or skepticism of a network, if you will. Obviously, if you're more negatively minded, right, these become holes for exploitation, which we'll end up talking about sort of the nefarious part of this. Now, a final thing that we thought a lot about was bridging as well. So if you look at the way content spreads online, language, not surprisingly, forms a really big barrier, right? I can't speak Spanish. So there's no reason for me necessarily to pay attention to Spanish language content. So the idea was, could we actually use bots to form kind of translation bridges between certain parts of a social graph to say, these two groups of people don't really see each other's news. Could we send in a bunch of bots to translate and then push that content from one part of the network to another, thereby lowering the friction of certain ideas passing around these platforms? So here's a set of experiments that we're trying, and you know, we're having a great time in Boston. And at the same time, I think we're starting to see a number of things start to pop up. So in 2011, we start to hear stories about Twitter bots being used to kind of drown out activism, right? So this is one of the early cases that we saw. which is sort of the use of bots on hashtags to basically drown out activists in Syria. And these were very rudimentary bots, basically. They were basically accounts that would say the same thing over and over and over and over again. And this was sort of interesting because this actually quickly changed, right? We saw the initial kind of wave of these tactics being tried out. And then in 2012, we actually saw them being used in a strategic way, so that there was an election in Mexico where both the incumbent candidate and the opposition were both using bots on either side to challenge one another. So not only was this a technique being used, but it was sort of being distributed and then being used against one another in sort of a strategic kind of way. And this pattern, I would say, we started our experimentation in 2011. This all this other stuff continued to accelerate over the kind of next few years. So, you know, by the time we get to 2014, we see things like this, which you may be familiar with, which is the Colombian chemicals hoax, which basically was a series of tweets that basically pushed the idea that there had been a chemical factory kind of explosion that took place in Louisiana. And what was interesting about it is that not only did we have bots repeating the same content, but we also had kind of the creation of entirely fabricated content as well, right? So the images being shared here are actually, they purport to be screen caps from CNN, but they are in fact kind of fabrications, right? They're photoshopped in certain types of stories to push the believability of certain things. 2014 was also really interesting, I would say, because we saw these campaigns move from just merely being a Twitter phenomenon to being a cross-platform one, right? Because the idea was if a phenomenon exists on multiple platforms, it's probably more believable. And so this campaign was also interesting because we also saw things like the creation of a Wikipedia page months before the actual campaign being launched to, again, bolster the credibility that something was in fact happening. And there's a number of kind of news stories that pop up as these stories are kind of coming into us and we're doing our research. So one of them is we also saw news of an increasing kind of government ecosystem around investing in these sorts of techniques. So this story, if you're interested in this and you've been following this for a while, there's this kind of famous-ish, micro-famous Adrian Chen story from 2015, noting kind of the existence of this Russian agency that's kind of focusing on sort of attempts to kind of manipulate social media. In addition to government actors, we also see the inclusion of solo contractors in the space as well. So there's a Bloomberg story last year, a fascinating report about this guy, Andres Sepulveda, who basically spent multiple years moving through Latin America being hired as a freelancer to help swing elections. And part of the tactics involve kind of traditional sort of cybersecurity things, so rigging voting machines and that sort of thing. But I think one of the things that stood out most for us was basically that it was noted for quote, less nuanced work, he had a larger army of 30,000 Twitter bots, automatic posters that could create trends, right? And so the idea is this is becoming kind of a component of a sort of black market, if you will, of persuasion-related services. We had kind of the weird experience of actually finding ourselves sucked into the story. So there was a leak from Snowden. It was a GCHQ leak that happened a few years back. And these are actually images from presentations we gave in another context, but like were basically publicly available. So we sort of ended up sort of becoming part of this story accidentally in some ways. And of course, in November of last year in the US, it appears that these are becoming kind of major instruments of state policy. So there's a US kind of director of national intelligence report that suggests kind of a large scale, sophisticated influence campaign from Russia in shaping the outcome of the 2016 election. So that kind of brings us to the present, right? And so there's a question I want to ask now that you have sort of the context and the background here, which is how do we size up what's happening here? There's obviously a lot of action and interest in the space. There's actors that appear to be investing in it. So there's a moment you could take a step back and take a skeptic's view and basically say, Tim, PsyOps of this kind have always been happening, so I don't know why we should particularly care about it just because it's happening on Twitter, right? And this is a leaflet missile, right? So a technique that was used during World War II, and since, of course, part of a long-standing piece of military deception and strategy, right, is spreading messages to change the perception of your opponents. Now, again, this is not just a World War II phenomenon that even stretches further back. So this is actually a piece of weaponized fake news, if you will. So produced by Benjamin Franklin from his letter press during peace negotiations with England in 1782. And so this broadside basically replicates a template of the Boston Independent Chronicle, which is a popular newspaper at the time. And basically, it uses the exact same fonts as the newspaper, the Boston Independent Chronicle, but substitutes a couple of articles documenting terrible war crimes by the British people. And the idea was that these papers were basically strategically seeded with editors in an attempt to get them reprinted in London, where they would actually cause, hopefully, enough outrage that it would pressure the British government to behave in a certain way. So this is a long-standing, obviously, component of our strategic landscape. But what I want to argue today and argue to you is that we should see these new tactics as something that's enough different in degree to be different in kind, right? The persuasion environment, in my opinion, is now critically different than the way it was when we were doing sort of leaflet bombing and imitating things on letterpresses. And I think there's four attributes that I think particularly stick out in my mind as why we're in a different space. So between leafleting and what we're seeing on Twitter, right? So on one hand, back in the day, if you imagine, okay, we're going to drop a bunch of leaflets over a country to influence their people, your model is very qualitative, right? You can say, we drop these leaflets, and it seems like there's more protests on the street right now. But we don't actually have a very fine-grained sense of the way people are behaving, right? As opposed to now, right? Which is, a bot can send a message, and I can immediately see whether or not that person repeats that message or responds to that message and how they respond. So we can generate these much more sophisticated quantitative models of influence that we didn't necessarily have before. A second one is kind of slow experimentation versus fast experimentation. So we're going to do some leafleting. I got to print those leaflets. I have to put them on our airplane. They have to fly over the country. We have to drop them, right? And that cycle of feedback is a lot slower, right? So what I want to argue is basically that it's much faster to do experimentation now. I can have 1,000 bots. Every 20 bots will launch a different message. We'll see which one is successful, and we can rapidly iterate. Right, so the speed of experimentation is another big attribute. A third one is we're moving from high cost of operations to low cost of operations. So if we wanted to do influence in the past, right, we have to have a radio station or a printing press. But again, of course, on Twitter, a lot of the experiments I just described were done by three people, like not in a garage, but in a living room. And then finally, slow reproducibility versus fast reproducibility. In the past, right, if we wanted to distribute these leaflets as part of a much larger campaign, we'd have to put them on pallets and move them all over the place. And it may be really difficult for me to kind of share know-how. But luckily, with software, it's easily copyable and distributable anywhere, right? So I think there's also fast reproducibility. If you find a tactic that really works in terms of influencing a group of people, you can make that distribute in a very broad way very, very quickly. So the argument I want to make is basically the persuasion environment is kind of critically different. And moreover, I think these tactics are going to become more sophisticated over time as well. So there's a DARPA study that concluded that, at least on the issue of bots, that bot developers are becoming increasingly sophisticated. And over the next few years, we can expect a proliferation of social media influence bots as advertisers, criminals, politicians, nation states, terrorists, and others attempt to influence populations, right? And so, let me make the argument to you not only why the influence environment is different, but also why we think these tactics are going to become more effective over time rather than less effective over time. Because I think you could take a skeptical view and say, look, you know, maybe when the first billboard went up, people said, oh, that guy on the big billboard told me to do something, so I'll go do it. But, you know, we got used to it over time and became more skeptical. But I think that's not the case this time, and I want to argue why. So in 2011, when we began, these were the kinds of bots that we saw, right? So these are three accounts that basically just say, I seriously love all of Lamar Wilson's videos. He's so funny, right? And it was basically just the same thing over and over again. And there's two major trends that I want to pick up on that that I think we're watching very carefully to see whether or not they actually change the game. So one of them is that there's these advances in machine learning, which seems to open up the possibility to make fake identities more believable. So to date, basically, campaigns of influence have been observed to be limited in the sense that there's trade-offs between scale and believability. In other words, if you think about it, I'm going to create a bot campaign to make it look like there's a mass protest on the street, right? I need to launch a lot of bots to make it look like that's the case, but it's really difficult for me to create a believable identity for each one of them. I can do that, but it'll take more money, right? I can do a smaller number of identities that have, you know, Facebook profiles and Wikipedia pages and all these other things, but that will be kind of more expensive for me to produce. So in general, there's been this trade-off where I can launch a larger bot campaign of less believable bots, usually to kind of spam, or a smaller bot campaign with more believable bots. But machine learning is enabling computers to create faces and also imitate faces in really interesting ways. So this is a study that was released recently, basically taking faces and using deep learning networks to essentially believably age them a certain number of years. And the results are pretty interesting. There was another one that I'll point out that, let me see, this video is always a dangerous move, but I will attempt to do it for you, which is a project that was launched recently called Face-to-Face, which basically leverages deep learning networks to learn representations of faces. So the idea here is basically that you can use, I gotta be able to get online. Let me see if that will work. One second. Give this one more shot. If not, I'll kind of explain what you would have seen. So, All right. As mentioned, video is always dangerous. So, what you would have seen, and I'm happy to send this around, basically, is Face-to-Face learns a representation of sort of faces of celebrities, right? So, the idea is you'll be able to kind of speak. And it's a really interesting demo because you're basically able to speak through the face of Donald Trump or George Bush or Vladimir Putin or whoever you want to be. And it basically creates kind of a very believable sort of video imitation. It basically learns a representation of their facial expressions and muscles and is able to kind of imitate that in real time. So finally, sequence-to-sequence models, which is a particular flavor of machine learning, uses data about conversational pairs. So are you free tomorrow? Yes, what's up? In ways that enable agents to respond and have conversations in realistic ways that are moving kind of pretty far beyond what we've been able to do in the past. A final one, if you're interested in examples along these lines, is a project called WaveNet, which is something that was just released by DeepMind late last year, and it basically allows the creation of simulated human speech audio in a way that, again, was very believable and has very high sort of fidelity. So I think that's one trend that we're watching very carefully, is the ability for these kind of computational techniques to create more believable identities. The second one I'll point out, which is basically, I think the second trend is our sort of broadening understanding of the way large social systems behave online. So when research was being done about social networks decades ago, it was very high cost to gather data. So Stanley Milgram, yes, that Stanley Milgram, the electrocuting one, actually worked on a project establishing sort of 6 degrees of connection, 6 degrees of separation between people. And again, it was basically an experiment that was done by postcard, right? And so it was expensive, it was noisy, it was difficult to pull off these experiments to kind of map social networks. But as Alex Pentland and others have pointed out, we're actually now awash in data about social behavior. And that gives us the ability to form kind of a new, what he calls a social physics, basically a much finer grained understanding of large scale social behavior and how to actively shape it through specific interventions. So that includes modeling, for example, how ideas spread and whether or not sort of particularly successful spreading of information can be predicted. And it also gives us the ability to kind of shape, right? So you may have seen this Facebook study where they were able to influence about sort of 340,000 extra people to turn out to vote. By putting up certain messages on social platforms. And this might, for example, and I think this kind of research and this knowledge creates lots of benefits, but also potentially gives the ability for bad actors much more know-how of how to effectively kind of spread misinformation, sow dissent, radicalize, and so on. So this is a little bit abstract, so I want to give a couple of examples, and then finally I think we'll talk to the actual like legal portion of this. So I think, first off, you could imagine, for example, an attack that combines sort of cyber attack with misinformation to destabilize economies. So there's a story a few years back of basically the AP Twitter account being hacked, a tweet being put out that there was a bomb at the White House, which caused this kind of big drop in Dow prices. You can imagine if there's a much more sustained misinformation effort, that it might be take a great deal more time for that market to stabilize, right? So you can imagine kind of these coordinated attacks that compromise certain accounts to spread influential ideas at certain times. We might use these campaigns to kind of autonomously recruit protesters and sow division at scale, right? So in the past, if you wanted to rally a bunch of people out on the streets, you'd actually have to have humans go in and interact with people. But it may be possible to create bots that, for example, identify which groups of people are angry and find ways of getting them organized autonomously, right? Lower the cost to getting people on the streets. These also might be combined with kinetic attacks, right? So imagine a bombing, right, which is combined with a misinformation campaign. So you plant a bomb in a certain part of the city, you explode that bomb, but then you spread lots of sort of misinformation to get people to go to more dangerous parts of the city to get harmed, right? So there's a lot of ways these different kind of threats end up interacting with one another. And I think more importantly, because they can be pulled off at low cost and difficult to attribute, this seems to be a recipe for much greater sort of global instability. So it begs the question then, what do we do about it? And so I think this is the kind of final portion, which I'll talk about sort of the current legal questions that emerge in these debates and where we might be able to move forward. So two questions. So one of them is, can international frameworks help us address this challenge? And finally, if not, what are the potential alternatives? And so there's a lot more detail we go into in the actual paper, but I want to raise some of the more kind of salient aspects, maybe as just good fodder for the discussion. So one important thing to know is, first off, that international law has largely not focused on PsyOps as something to deal with. Largely what you find is basically a series of laws or provisions that deal with very specific cases. So for example, the International Convention on the Suppression of Acts of Nuclear Terrorism makes it a crime to threaten to use nuclear material for, quote, under circumstances which indicate the credibility of a threat. So you can imagine, for example, if you launched a PsyOps campaign that was largely focused around nuclear weapons and the use of nuclear weapons, right, that might become something that kind of runs afoul of our existing international frameworks. Similarly, Article 20 of the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights states that, quote, any propaganda for war shall be prohibited by law, and further that any advocacy of any national, racial, religious hatred that constitutes incitement to discrimination, hostility, or violence shall be prohibited by law. So again, these are kind of very specific forms of coverage. If I launched a disinformation campaign with the purposes of creating sort of propaganda for war, that might actually produce kind of grounds under the existing international framework. But the thing is, enforcement is ultimately kind of spotty on this, and so we only have a couple of specific cases in which these things are actually like prosecuted. So one example is the International Criminal Tribunal for Rwanda, which basically prosecuted a number of people who ran a radio station. I think the initials are RTLMC. And basically, the radio station put out messages that incited genocide, right? In that case, it was found that the pushing of those messages was itself kind of the crime. And so the rule is basically, insofar as you spread these messages that are proximate causes of other things that we have banned, then we don't think it's acceptable. But as you mine the history, there's actually this really intriguing kind of history about the attempts to kind of ban or address PsyOps as a broad category of thing. So in 1999, the Secretary General of the UN put out this comment, basically looking for comments on developments in the field of information and telecommunications in the context of international security. And a number of nations submitted their views on this topic. And so there's one country that did flag a number of things that are relevant to our current day discussion. So one of them, they said, the main threat to international information security are, and among other things, the use of information with a view to undermining a state's political and social system, psychological manipulation of a population for the purpose of destabilizing society, so on and so forth. They go on to say, this country, that the main tasks of the international community should be identifying future information war possibilities, restricting traffic in information weapons, prohibiting the use. And of course, the really interesting thing here is that the country that put these forward is Russia in 1999. And it was actually, in fact, the US that said that we don't want a ban. So the politics of this, I think, become very fascinating as you kind of mine up the history of these attempts to kind of put a rule in place around control of PsyOps. Now, there's another set of kind of rules in international law that might become relevant here. So beyond places, looking for places where PsyOps might be explicitly mentioned, we can also think about places where these tactics might be applied in kind of a broader international legal framework. So one of these things is we might actually see these campaigns as equivalent to an act of war, right? If you spread a PsyOps campaign that ends up undermining my government, it seems like you've reached the same result as maybe using sort of military kind of traditional weapons, in which case the laws of war might apply. We might also see these campaigns as attacks covered by defensive treaties, right? So Article 5 of NATO say that if there's an armed attack, right, there's an attack, then we might be able to activate this as a defensive treaty. But limitations apply, because in many of these cases, armament or aggression has referred to actual physical aggression, right? So it's some of the same problems that you see emerge in the cyber kind of warfare space. But I would say for all of these, there's kind of three themes I want to pick up on that are interesting problems. I think they're thematic issues that all international frameworks will have to deal with in the space, and they'll have to need to be either overcome or resolved in some way to create an effective approach. So the first one is the issue of definition, right? What is exactly a PsyOp that we are worried about, and how would we craft a law to deal with that? Right, so if Barack Obama travels to the UK to urge against Brexit, right, that is the influence of one nation attempting to influence kind of the policy or behaviors of another. Should that count as a kind of PSYOP, right? And if so, or if not, why, and where would you draw those boundaries? So I think that's one important challenge. Another one is sovereignty, right? So traditionally, nations are the kind of contracting entities in international law, and sort of violations on their sovereignty are what kind of triggers a bunch of things. But sovereignty hasn't traditionally meant the hearts and minds of the citizens within a country, and would be theoretically be uncomfortable about the idea of establishing a rule that countries and what is part of countryness is sort of the beliefs of the citizens that exist inside it, right? And the exclusive control over that is one of the things that's necessary for nationhood. Well, I think that's sort of an interesting thing we might want to talk about. I think a final one is, what is proportionality in the space as well? So does a PSYOP permit military action and response? You try to manipulate my election, I shoot a bomb at you, right? Now, we have some emerging trends, right? So Obama, in his final days in office, did put sanctions down, right? So which you imagine could be something where sort of economic sanctions and the expulsion of diplomats and spies could be something that's considered proportional to a PSYOP. But again, you can imagine that if we don't set this balance up right, there's a lot of challenge, there's a lot of potential for abuse, particularly with the definitional problems. You tried to influence me, so now we're going to invade your country, right? And I think that's a really interesting question of how do you set up proportionality in the space. So a lot of big conceptual problems, ultimately, these are questions of norms, right? So one model we identify in the paper that's promising is the model of regional cooperation, where the incentives of actors, the threats that they face, and what's permissible might be fairly aligned. So the EU actually ends up being a really interesting model here because they've been largely motivated by the use of these techniques by Russia in the electoral context. So there's kind of an emerging ecosystem. I'll highlight three of them that might be of interest. So one of them is in NATO, there's now a Strategic Communications Center of Excellence, which is kind of studying these sort of PSYOPs campaigns and then attempting to disseminate expertise among different militaries and intelligence communities. The OSCE now has a representative on freedom of the media, which has done a lot of different things, right? But is now kind of focusing on sort of PSYOPs-related campaigns, issuing communiques and potentially kind of positioning and kind of increasing, hopefully, policy pressure to take some kind of action. And then finally, the EU itself now has the European External Action Service, which is kind of monitoring and actually has an active counter-messaging campaign against Russia operating out of their sort of organization. But I think what's interesting about this discussion, and I think why it's interesting that this was able to come out the way at the time it did, is I think we're approaching some real tests of whether or not these countermeasures will work in the coming year. So I think there's a remaining open question of what else we could do. And maybe this is a good place to sort of finally kind of wrap up, which is, to this, I think in our paper we suggest a couple of options, each with benefits and limitations. I'll sketch them out really quickly. Maybe they, again, create kind of good fodder for discussion. So one of the things we point out is improving transparency. Right? So maybe we create these international bodies, which will sort of investigate and attempt to attribute these kinds of campaigns. So there's some pros, right, that avoids some of the legal questions that we have above. But there's also cons, right? We don't know if necessarily naming and shaming is going to prevent countries from engaging this activity. It might have also uneven coverage. You can imagine that if you're a nation that donates this kind of investigative body, you sort of don't want to be found out yourself. So there might be some limitations in the use of that lever. We could imagine enhancing public robustness. So the idea here is, can we engage in these media literacy campaigns that encourage people to evaluate whether or not something is true or not online? So again, the pro of that is, if we're successful, we reduce the effectiveness of these techniques overall. The con, of course, is that it's slow. We don't know if we can get good coverage, so there's problems there. And I think the final one I'll point at is kind of changing platform behavior, and I think this will become a really interesting interface, which is, could the nations pressure these various companies to do more to eliminate or attack sort of misinformation online? So the pro of that is that it's potentially fast and high leverage, right? If a company feels like its hands are being forced, it might be able to implement policies very quickly. the con, of course, is that there's a number of kind of disturbing and uncomfortable potential free speech implications with having nations be able to pressure platforms in this particular way. So as I said at the very, very beginning, a lot of questions, not a whole lot of answers. But I think it's an open question in a pretty fast-moving environment. It remains kind of unclear what sort of countermeasures are going to be the most effective here. It also remains unclear how we want to implement those tactics in an institutional way. So looking forward to discussion. This is my kind of obligatory contact information, and I figured Leanne and myself would be happy to kind of take your questions and engage in any discussion. So thanks for your time.